Hi, folks. Well, another week has slipped through our fingers. Good old time. It's like, it's greasy, you know, and slippery. You can't take hold of it and stop it. It just keeps on running by. And we're a week older. And 1 week closer to our salvation. There are people out there, I'm already saved, Ed. I'm glad you're of that opinion. I hope you are. It is written, as each day passes, we're one step closer to our salvation. Paul spoke at length about his running the race to salvation, to the deliverance of his soul. So it's not really that wise to count your chickens before they're hatched, you might say. Anyways, I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, I hope God has a sense of humor. Let's discuss women and salvation. Now this video, if you listen carefully, you'll be blessed by it. If you don't listen, and you don't test, and you take everything I say at face value, well, you'll probably think I'm an idiot. That's okay. There's only two women in Scripture that God speaks of, and that's Sarah and Hagar. Now it says that Hagar will never share in the inheritance with the free woman's sons. So it's pretty obvious Hagar will never share the inheritance with Sarah's sons. Yeah. So it's kind of like Sarah's the good one and Hagar's, that's the good. Well, when you get to the end of the whole story, you know, when you get to the final judgment and what the scripture has to say about that, we find there's only sheep and goats. There is nothing else. Okay. I don't think it's much of a stretch to put the sheep as Sarah and the goats as Hagar. I don't think that's a very, very far stretch. But we'll see in time. We'll discuss it and we'll see if maybe this is a correct assumption. Now, Sarah is the free woman. Hagar is the woman who is the slave woman. She's in bondage. Now, some might say, well, no, come on, Sarah was Abraham's wife and Hagar was Abraham's concubine and, you know, the Egyptian girl. And it's crazy just try and think that we're talking about something else. Well, sorry to bust some people's bubble, but yeah, we're talking about something else. The natural came first that the spiritual might be revealed. We look at the picture that's presented of Abraham's wife, Sarah, and the picture that's presented of the concubine, you know, Hagar. And there's something to be learned from it that's applicable today. And not in that one, and that one, or that one, but in here. In every single one of us, God's talking to each of us individually. Pretty personal. As we grow and we learn, we realize God's pretty personal. He's not some joker sitting up on a big throne somewhere, you know what I mean, orchestrating the pawns on this chessboard. No, he's pretty personal. He's right beside each and every one of us. guiding us. He truly is. He's personal. We, in our video on Adam and Eve, we discovered that Adam represents logic and that Eve represents emotion. Now, if I want to take everything literal, Adam's got a dick and Eve's got a vagina. So if it's talking about woman, it ain't talking about me, because I got a dick. See how absolutely ridiculous that is? God doesn't separate the sexes. God didn't make man and call him something else, or call her something else. Adam named woman because she comes from, she was a part of man that was removed. Remember the rib? But when you search that word rib in the King James Version, you come to the conclusion that, oh crap, it means a part. A part. It's not a, you know, let's physically rip a bone out of some jock and make a woman. You know what I mean? No, it's a part. Well, what part? You know, look at men and look at women, and what's missing from men, and what's sometimes absent in women? Well, again, aren't we back to logic and emotion? Women aren't emotional creatures. Men are more logical creatures. They suppress their emotions more. Not that they don't have emotion, you know, but they're more suppressed with men. Men like to see things logically. Women, of course, they'll often cast away logic to have, embrace emotion, you know. Women in salvation, topic of the video, women in salvation. It says that woman will be saved by childbearing. And you want to know something I've seen in my years? I'm not lying. Young girls hear this and are even told this by their mothers, and they'll go out and get themselves pregnant on purpose. They view sexual intercourse as something good, because by it, they think they'll be saved. Because it says women will be saved through childbearing. So they take it literal, right to the core, and off they run. And you end up with an awful lot of unwed mothers. You can deny what I say is true, but if you look out there, you're going to find it's true. So what does it mean then when Paul said women are saved through childbearing? What's Paul talking about? Is he talking about the sexes? Is he talking gender? No. No, it's got nothing to do with that, his conversation. Nothing. And yet I'm willing to bet, I'll bet you cold hard cash that you've been around a lot of people in your lifetime that have taken Paul's discussions on marriage, on the male and the female, and even on what people think is homosexuality, and have taken it completely literally. Completely literally. Yeah. And guess what? They're full of shit. They haven't got a clue what they're talking about. Because Paul is speaking spiritually. He even tells us that. You know, he goes through a long discourse about a husband and a wife and marriage, you know, and children, and a huge discourse on it. And then he turns around at the end of it and he says, I'm talking about God, Christ, and the church. That's what I'm talking about. Christ and the church. Huh? But people just take it literally and think they understand something. They don't. Women and salvation, topic of our video. Woman is saved through childbearing. What does it mean to bear children? What does it mean? Is it talking about sperm and ovum and conception and the womb and a child coming forth from between a woman's legs? Is this what childbearing's talking about? Or is it talking about spending oneself? Be you male or female as far as gender is concerned. But spending yourself. To do away with the pointing finger and the malicious tongue. And spend yourself to share the truth with people. And love on them. Show a little kindness. Show a little compassion. Show a little mercy. Forgive. Even as you've been forgiven. Tell people about the Lord. Not to be ashamed of our God. There's a lot of people who are ashamed of Jesus. I got a replacement for the PT Cruiser. It's a Ford Black Ford Focus. It's not new, it's a used car, but I got it at a pretty good price and it'll serve my purpose. But I feel naked. I feel awful driving to town. Parking in town. What testimony am I giving? I mean, come on, you know. I'm the kind of person, I want to scream it from the rooftops. But I'm also prudent enough to realize that it doesn't serve much of a purpose to stand in the streets and scream and yell at people. It just doesn't serve much of a purpose. But there's other ways. And my way that I've chosen for 15 years with the PT Cruiser was those signs on the back of the car and those flames. They all mean something, and time has proven to me that they do get people's attention. We've been numerous occasions been run off the road. I couldn't even begin to count the number of people who have come up behind the car, the cruiser, and read those signs and then stomped on the gas and come ripping around us and cut right in on us, you know, and flipped us the bird as they're going by. Offensive. Oh, some people really take offense at what those signs say. Father Truth, His Spirit Love. The Son, the form of God. With Star of David in the middle of it. Yeah. Lots of people take offense. But I've also been, I don't know what the word is, confronted, you know, by Hell's Angels, banditos, guys on bikes, who look pretty rough. And they've said thank you. You've opened my eyes to understand something that I never realized before. We had a native family, a whole family. They spotted those signs. Man, I'm telling you, they had their cell phones out. And they wanted us to come out and stand beside the car. They could take pictures of the back of the car and pots. It's power in those signs. They tell people something. And I feel naked driving around this Ford Focus with nothing on it. Wendy's designed a new set of signs, and I'm trying to get... I was going to paint them on, and I'm thinking maybe I should have. You know, I'd have them done by now. I should have just painted them on myself and been done with it. But it's a huge amount of work to paint all those letters and the flames and everything, you know, and mask the whole car off and all that. A lot of work. So I thought this time I'd use stickers, you know. Vinyl decals, but I'm having a hard time getting them made. It took me a while to make them, you know, to find something that suits, you know. There's lots of flames on the internet, but boy, do they suck. Nobody ever think that maybe when you design a set of flames, you should design them for specific makes and models of cars so that they fit properly, so that they actually accentuate the lines and don't come out of the mirror, you know, or out of nowhere, you know, behind the front wheel. Or I like old school flames done right myself. And believe me, these new flames that we have designed are pretty nice. And they fit that Ford Focus really well. And I've got, where did they go? I found a guy in California who had my little envelope. He sent them in. And they're just small little stickers. I don't know if you can actually see them or not, but that's a cross. And that's the Star of David. And, I mean, I gotta make everything fit the back of the Focus. I had to go this small. Hopefully they're still big enough to read, you know, to see. And then, of course, above the Star of David, it's Father Truth, and then Spirit Love, and then Son, the form of God. And this one is Jesus across the top, the Messiah across the bottom, or the Christ. And then I've got my little beast sign, and I've got well, there's a lot of stuff, but I got started anyways. And hopefully we'll get this Ford Focus offering the gospel the way it should. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. But lots of people are. They dare not talk about Christ. They dare not sit and open their mouths and say something about God. Or push the conversation, you know, when you're amongst other people, in public and private, you know, in the coffee shop, and wherever. I'm not like that. I'm not ashamed of my God. When people want to talk about Islam or other religions or anything like that, I'm quick. To pop into the conversation and tell people, don't be too quick to assimilate their God with our God, because they're not the same God at all. You know what I mean? Women are saved through childbearing. other place it says Adam wasn't the one who sinned. It was Eve who was deceived. Yeah, it was. Is it not emotion who's always deceived? Remember God talking to each and every one of us individually? Is it not emotion that is always deceived and deceives? Oh, but I want. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with emotion. We've all got emotion. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with logic. We've all got logic. Adam and Eve and every one of us. Getting personal, isn't it, eh? Yeah, it's getting personal. Adam and Eve and each and every one of us. Adam was charged to follow God. Eve was charged to follow Adam. So if Adam is charged to follow God, then Adam better be searching the scriptures for the voice of God. He better be listening pretty careful to catch that esoteric side of wisdom. He better be aware that there are two sides to wisdom. He better be understanding that, you know, salvation is a growing procedure. It's not, poof, I'm saved. Not what the scriptures say. We're supposed to grow up into Christ, who is the head of the body. We're supposed to be the body. Is the body not the mother? Is God not the father? It says, do not call any man father, for you have but one father, and he's in heaven. Isn't that right? Isn't that correct? It is in my world. And I hope it is in yours as well. Women are saved through childbearing. You catching any of it yet? The emotion side in each and every one of us is dependent on bearing children. The children of God. Not the children of the devil, but the children of God. We can bear either one. I'm quite capable of sitting here and telling people bullshit lies that I guarantee you'll fall for them and it'll destroy you. I guarantee you, I'm quite capable of doing that. I know the devil. I know how he deceives. So do you. All I got to do is start running with the exoteric side of wisdom, and I guarantee I'll have every one of you believe in a lie in no time at all. No time at all. I won't do that. Love prevents me from doing that. I won't do that to people. If I haven't got something of value to share with you, I'll keep my mouth shut. If I haven't got a revelation or an interpretation, which is the interpretation of the tongues of the prophets is prophecy, so if I haven't got a prophecy for you, I'd say nothing. Certainly won't run around calling myself a prophet of God and telling you all the exoteric bullshit that pops into my head. That ain't prophesying. That ain't doing any service to God. I'll tell you that right now. My opinion's as worthless as your opinion is. But if your opinion is based on what the scriptures tell us, well, then it ain't you speaking, is it? It's the Spirit in you speaking through you. When what you say is what the scriptures tell us and explain to us. I don't prevent anyone from speaking in tongues, reading, quoting scripture, but interpret it. Search those same scriptures for the esoteric side of what it's telling us. Women in salvation that have anything to do with gender, penises and vaginas? Nope. Not a thing. He made them both male and female, and he called them man. It's got nothing to do with gender. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. We all are called. God calls to everyone. Men and women equally. All in the same boat. And God's pretty personal. I'm just repeating things I've already said, aren't I? Women in salvation. It says in the scriptures, it says it's disgusting for a man to dress himself as a woman. Oh, my. A picture in my mind, you know, there was a time where if a woman wore trousers, that was just disgusting. Or if a man wore a skirt, that was just disgusting, you know, I guess. Everybody, all the boys in Scotland that wear the kilt, you know, they're just disgusting, I guess. But it isn't talking about that, is it? When a man dresses himself as a woman. You ever see that? You ever see where logic takes on the guise of emotion? You ever seen where emotion masquerades as logic? Ever seen that? Boy, if you haven't, you haven't been paying attention. You haven't been paying attention if you haven't seen that. I see that all the time, and it's disgusting. It's disgusting that anybody would do that. Men dressing themselves as women. Shut up, you son of a bitch. Wow. You see how stupid it is? Men in church getting louder and louder and louder and then having a little hissy fit, stomping out, or women. Women quoting scripture and wagging their finger in your face and telling you, you're the Antichrist. You're not in favor of union. You divide the church with your words. See that? Oh boy, I see it all the time. How can you not laugh? My God in heaven. People think they understand something and they're so... They're blind. They're naked. They're wretched. They're pitiful. They're poor. And yet they say, oh, I'm so blessed. Remind you of a place in Scripture? It should. Women in salvation. Women are saved through childbearing. Men are saved through listening to and following God. What was Adam's mistake in the garden? Eve's mistake, of course, is she lusted to be God, become God. You remember the devil's deception, you know? She said, you know, she used logic at first and said, no, God said that we weren't to eat of that or we'd die. And the devil turned around and said, oh, you won't die. God knows that you become just like God yourself when you eat it. You're going to die. And good old emotion is sitting there thinking, I get to be like God? Wow. I'm going to eat of that. God said, don't touch. Knowledge of good and evil, eh? It's not good. The knowledge of good and evil is not a tree from which we should eat. It's just not. It's judgmental. You know what I mean? Oh, I'm going to condemn you to hell because I am so righteous. I think this is good and I think that is bad. Based on what? You're a logic driven by emotion? Your emotion driven by your worldly logic? Your knowledge of good and evil? Instead of driven by the tree of life? Excuse me? We have to be careful. We have to be careful. Women and salvation. The woman, emotion, is saved through bearing the children of God, not condemning them to hell, but bearing them, helping them to grow, learning oneself what God says about things so that we can help others learn. Bearing the children of God. Adam is logic, Eve is emotion. You can deny that till the hounds come home, I don't care. I'm telling you the truth. It's personal. And it hits home. Right here, and right here. Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Lord willing, we'll see you again next week. Bye for now.